So welcome to the last day of the school on big data. Today we will have last two lectures on property testing by Saurav Chakravarty from Indian Statistical Institute, Calcutta. He did his PhD from University of Chicago, and he has been working. He first worked at CMI as a faculty, and then he moved to Indian Statistical Institute. So his main area of research is theoretical computer science with focus on classical and quantum complexity of Boolean functions, including property testing. And in the next two lectures, Saurav will be talking about property testing, which is very close to the kind of algorithms we saw in big data, but in a slightly different paradigm. Saurav, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Saket. So I realize that this is the last two lectures of this kind of a longish winter school. And so you must have already got some lot of information to digest in the last 10 days or so. And at the same time, you guys are tired, or maybe not, I don't know. So I would like to have this particular session, the next two classes, more like an interactive stuff. Okay, because whatever I'm going to say now, I'm not going to go into too much technicalities of various things, but I would be just be pointing out certain things that naturally happens in the world, and what are the theoretical aspects of them, and how are they related to the practical side of it. Okay. So before I go into the slides that I have made, oh, by the way, I don't have to say it again, that at any point of time, if you don't understand something or have some questions, comments, doubts, just unmute yourself and shout out. Okay. So let me say, so this is a school that has been happening on big data, right? Let me ask you the simple thing. Yeah, so question is that, so what is big data? If I ask you this question after all this winter school that you have had got, what do you think is big data is? Can somebody answer that? Anybody want to take a shot at it? Nobody? Yeah, so I mean, of course, there is nothing, there is no subject called big data, but it is basically, the idea is that data is large. And the large, I mean, very large. I mean, it's a massive data. So we have in our disposal nowadays massive quantities of data. Okay, and we want to do the exactly the same thing that we want to do earlier. So what we want is to process the data and give some knowledgeable facts about that data. Okay, or extract some knowledgeable information, some non-trivial facts or observations. Okay, so now if the data is big, and when I say big, it means really big, something that you possibly can't even store it in a single computer, or data that can be you don't want to store it in a particular RAM at least. So things like which are completely, in some sense, we have this huge data, but it is kind of inaccessible. So in that case, what we can do is that we want to still do this whole thing. We still want to process this whole data and extract some non-trivial information, right? But we are now constrained by it. What is the constraint that we have? So we have the huge data. The main constraint that we have is that we can't even hope to look at all the data. If not look at, maybe I will underline look at. So look at is not the right word, maybe. Means we cannot store the whole data. I mean, the data is there somewhere. It is in some external storage system or somewhere. So data exists, but when we are trying to process the whole data, we don't even have the bandwidth or space to look at this thing. So this is a typical problem that we happen all the time. Okay. And question is that in this case, what can we do? So then what can we do? So let me give you three examples, and I will possibly use those three examples as some kind of a guiding examples for most of my lecture today. So the first example. So by the way, have you guys all seen something like a clustering algorithm?
Oh yes, sir.
Okay, very good. So you have no clustering algorithm, right? So let me just make my life a bit simple and say that I have been given n points in, say, some d-dimensional space. Okay. And I want to check if the n points, or if the points, I will not say n points, if the points can be covered or clustered in some, you can think of covered by say k unit bots. Okay, now this is slightly different from clustering. In the clustering, you try to want to cluster them and you don't have the unitness in the ball's size that much, but this is very similar to clustering. Okay, just for this, we make our, for just for our making our problem simple, we have considered this. Sorry, dogs barking. By the way, if my handwriting is not good and you don't understand something, again, please do stop me. Okay. So is this clear? This problem? What do we want to do? Excellent. Yeah, so I have this chat box. Can you see the chat box actually when I'm, or can you just see my screen? You're not able to see my chat box, right? Fine. So I will just keep my chat box on, and you can of course keep on sending me messages on the chat box. Okay. So now the issue that we have here is that this number n is a massive number. Okay, of course, we know some nice examples or nice algorithms that helps us to check this thing. Okay, is it clusterable into k clusters? I mean, if you really want to make it slightly different, we can say that can be covered to understand it. Okay. And the question is that we have this huge number n, and most of the time people in the world of data science are more interested in this dimension d. I mean, if what happens if the dimension is large, these large dimension issues and all. That is one part of it. But the other part of it is this number n. What happens if this n is huge? Okay, so we can't even say, we don't even have the space or storage or amount of time to store this set of n data. Okay, in that case, what can we do? So can we do something? Now, what is do something means? We have to think of it by looking at something much, much less than n number of points. And this is the area. I mean, so if we look at much less the number of points, then you can hope to come up with algorithms and space complexity, with space complexity and time complexity much, much less than n, right? So this area is what we call as the sublinear algorithm. Okay. Now let's see. We don't even have linear amount of space and time. Yeah. And we are going to store only a very small fraction of the amount of information that we have in our hand. So do you think we can answer this particular question correctly? Do you think that it is possible for us to answer this question correctly?
So we could answer it to our degree of approximation.
Good. So we cannot answer it correctly, but we can answer it to some degree of approximation. Right? So we have to give something away to it. Now, so what kind of approximation can we say? Right? So there are again a lot of number of approximations that we can talk about. Okay. So one approximation that is usually done is that what happens if I want to find the minimum number of balls required to cover these endpoints. And I cannot answer exactly the minimum number of balls required, but I can output a number which is close to the minimum. That's an approximation algorithm that we can think of. In the sense, we can say, see, given an endpoint that can be clustered using k balls, I will give you maybe 2k clusters, or I will give you k square clusters. So that is one kind of approximation that one can think for. This is what is done in the standard approximation algorithms. Right? You're trying to approximate the optimized thing that you want to try to optimize. But for a normal approximation algorithms, even then you have to look at the whole points. So that is not good for us. We can't even read all the points. And yet we are expected to output something non-trivial. So our output should be an approximation that kind of tolerates some amount of error in the input. So in some sense that, okay, see, somebody comes up and gives you an endpoint that can be put up into k clusters or k unit balls. Very good. And somebody else comes up and gives you the same set of points, but gives you one additional point, which is far away from these endpoints. So of course, this new set of points cannot be clustered using k cluster. So somebody comes up and says that, okay, see, these are my points. Okay, this can be clustered using 3 clusters. Fine, very good. But then I come up and say that, oh, this is my point, but then I have one point here. Now, what you can understand by saying this is that this set of points, it is basically 3 clusterable, right? It basically has 3 clusters, 1, 2, 3. This point is more like an outlier. So, can we say something? Can we formalize it? A typical way of it is that I want to understand something. Okay. So, what can we say? So, please look at this one. Given I want to check it if it is clusterable using k clusters. So, when will I say it to be no? When will my answer be no to this question? Think of it in an approximation kind of setting. So I can say that, okay, yeah, some, go ahead.
Even some percentage of points are outside, like I cannot divide them in K clusters without having a large percentage of points still outside.
Exactly. So I can say no, if for any K unit balls or unit balls or K clusters or whatever you want to call it here, say K clusters, there exists say delta n fraction or some fraction, delta n, or say, I will not say delta n, but delta fraction of the points are outside the K balls or K clusters. Meaning, however way I come up with some K clusters or K balls, I will always find some big chunk of them outside. So this is like a clear no kind of stuff. That see, however hard I try, the delta is say for maybe 5%. Means 0.05. So it means that however hard I try, I will not be able to cover 5% of the points using K clusters. Now, good. So this is no. Is there any doubts about that? Anybody has any comments, questions? They don't agree with this is the right definition of, this is something that can be rejected or something. Kind of we'll all agree more to it. Maybe we'll be worried about what is this n? What is this delta? Why delta fraction? Should we look at some other kind of a notion of fairness? Yes, so there are such issues that can be asked about, that what about the notions of fairness and so on, meaning this delta fraction of the points, can the delta be 1 over n fraction or something like that. But more or less, we are kind of happy with this. But what is the yes instance? When we will say it yes? See, of course, if the points are clusterable using K clusters, we should say yes. There's no question about that. But can we say yes some other times also? So maybe what happens if we say that if there exist K clusters or K balls such that the number of points outside the K balls is less than, So by the way, this should have been more than, there exists more than or equal to, and this is at less than delta fraction, less than epsilon fraction of the points, such that the number of points is at most the epsilon fraction of the points. So there will be, there will be some outliers, but the total number of outliers are very small. And in that case, I would like to say it to be, that they are, I'm happy with it. They are possibly K clusterable. There are some outliers. Right. So note that in this definition, of course, what we'll have is that epsilon must be less than delta. Else the case of no instance and yes instance might clash. Maybe for our purpose, we can also think of that epsilon and delta is some significantly less. I mean, epsilon is significantly less than delta. Maybe there is a gap between these two. So let's see what we are. So we started with this question, and instead of answering it exactly, we have boiled down to this question. Where what we are doing, we are saying is that, okay, if there exist some K balls or K clusters that covers most of the points, please accept. If there is no cluster that covers more than some 1 minus delta fraction of the points, then reject, right? But this also leaves you a little bit of a gap in the middle. What happens if my points are such that it is neither in the no instance nor in the yes instance. In that case, what can we say? In that case, maybe we can say that, see, I mean, this is like a very tight thing. We can, of course, make epsilon equals to delta, and then in that case, the no instance and yes instance will just be complement of each other. But then it will be very hard to solve it. We have to kind of look at all the points. I mean, like this example, right? Like in this example, if you remove, so there might be one or two points which are the outliers. And it is hard to exactly answer whether there is this K clusters or not, unless we see all the outliers. So that means we have to go through all the points. So we should, I mean, and that is not what we want, right? We don't want to go over all the points. So there should be kind of a, you can think of, there is a gap. So there is a gap. So there is a gap between yes instances or no instances. So basically, if my instance or input is neither this sure shot no, neither is a sure shot yes, then I kind of say that, see, I don't know what is it. I am unable to answer that. Okay, so this kind of, we also sometimes call it as the promise. Meaning we assume that the input is either in the yes instance or in the no instance. I'm not going to give you anything which is in the middle of this. So with this extra promise that we have, so that means, see, what we are. So if it is close to being clusterable, then I want to accept it or say yes. If it is far from being clusterable, K clusterable, then I want to say no. Right? And my goal is to answer this question by looking at a very small number of points. So this is what we call as property test. So is this problem clear? So this is what we can call as the property testing. So property testing is the subject in which we, so in property testing, we are given an input, and a property. So in this case, the property is basically, are the points clusterable into K clusters or not? And you have to design a sublinear algorithm, an algorithm that don't even read all the points, all the input algorithm. And one, if the input is close to having a property, then output yes. If the input is far from having the property, then output no. And the third thing that is not told, but I can tell it, is that if the input is neither close nor far from having the property, then output anything you want. output anything. So basically, you will not be judged by what you do in this case. Your algorithm will not be judged here. Your algorithm is allowed to make mistakes there. But more importantly, there are only three things that has to be kind of looked into. Number one, this one, if it is close to having a property, you should answer yes. If it is far from having a property, you should answer no. And it should be sublinear. So you can see this concept of property testing in this world of clustering. And maybe you can kind of understand that if the number of points is actually quite a lot, if this n is a massive number n, then I am more interested in a question like this than in the exact question like this. I am ready to give up a little bit of error at the same time gain in the time complexity and space complexity. Is this problem clear? Okay, good. So this is one problem. Now, do you guys want to think about how to solve this problem? Do you guys want to just have a go at it? So just maybe why not we do some kind of a little bit of a workshop kind of stuff and say that, okay, so consider the same problem, okay? This same problem, given an endpoint, I want to check if it is covered with k unit poles. Just let's make the k to be equal to 1. Okay, and then let's try to understand it. So I have given endpoints, and I want to check if the points were in Rd and can be covered using one unit ball. I mean, this is just a one clustering question, right? Can you come up with a property testing algorithm for this? Can you come up with a sublinear algorithm that kind of answers this question? So in other words, if a lot of or majority of the points or a 1 minus epsilon fraction of the points can be covered using one ball, then I should answer yes. If no unit ball can cover more than 1 minus delta fraction of the points, then I should answer no. Okay, and that's about it. I mean, in the middle, I don't care. So let's say delta equals to, just for the heck of it, just say I assume that delta equals to 0.05 and epsilon equals to 0.01. Meaning if there are at most 1% of the points are outliers, then accept. And if at least 5% of the points are outside the ball, then reject. Now, how do you think you should be able to attack this problem? Can you come up with a way to design this problem, design an algorithm for this?
So one way could be, a naive way could be to break the n points into, let's say, root n chunks or something, and okay, take 1 point each from each chunk.
Correct. And then?
Then we would just simply check if those root n points can be covered with a unit ball, and we give our answer based on what we get as a result of that.
So you are taking root n chunks, and you are just going to check whether all the root n points can be covered using this chunk or not, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So basically what you are trying to do is basically what we can call as simple sampling. You are just doing a little bit different from sampling, but we are kind of, so the most, I mean, the first approach, say, first attempt can be pick, say, as you say, kind of maybe say, pick root n points at random. I mean, I'm just going to rephrase whatever you have just told in a different way. Okay. Pick root n point at random and check if the root n points can be covered using one unit point. And now you are going to maybe repeat it a few times, or maybe you are trying to just partition them in the n points into root n chunks of root n size each randomly and try to check all of that. Now, good. So this is an attempt, and this is a good attempt. Why? What can you guarantee here? Say I look at the root n point and I realize that, oh, see, in this root n point, okay, in this root n point, a lot of points are, and even at this, even some root n points, I cannot store it with the, cover it with the, say if I find some root n points, and so say I have got some root n points over here, and so these are the some root n points, okay? So remember that there are some other points here, right? Which we have not picked up. The red points are the ones that we have not picked up. And in this one, in the purple points, maybe I should have given a different shape to them. Maybe these are my selected points. And if I try to cover this selected point using a unit ball, what I realize is that a big chunk of them are always going out. So that actually only means that, so that means only a constant fraction of the delta fraction of the root n points are outside of every unit ball. But the main idea here is randomness. If you pick this root n points at random, then what do you hope? That if the best, I mean, if you pick, if you pick some, forget root n or not, right? You pick a random subset. So maybe let me just, sorry. So consider the no instance, okay? Let's think of the no instance. Okay, so what does it mean? That any unit ball will leave out delta fraction of points, right? So if we pick a subset S of points, okay, and say the subset S is of size something, I don't care, say L, then what can we expect? What to expect? How many points do you think will be left out of a unit point, unit ball in S? Any suggestions?
A delta of L?
Delta of L. Yeah. So what we expect is that any unit point, unit ball, will leave out delta fraction of points in S. So this is an expectation, okay? This is what happens, what we, this is an expectation, delta fraction of the points in S will be left out. Okay, this is a no instance. Now, I don't know how much of you have seen these things. Have you got gone over concentration inequalities like Chernoff, Markov and so on?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you will be able to prove that if this is the case, okay, if this, when you are in the no instance, then you pick up a random S, then not only it will leave out a delta fraction, but with high probability, you can say that the number of points that are left out, okay, would be a delta fraction, or close to a delta fraction. Okay, but okay. So a standard thing that can happen is that you have n points, you say select or choose randomly square root n number of subset of that set of points and check how many of those points can be covered using a unit ball. The fraction of points that are left out would be a good indication for this point. And this is what will help you to completely understand this whole thing, meaning to estimate this delta. You can also do it for the yes instance, the same way. So it is basically sampling. Okay. Now there is one catch over here that I kind of did not specify. So whatever I have told there, does it make sense to you guys? Somewhat? Hello? Does it make sense to you guys that if you pick up a random subset and then you estimate the number of points that will be left out, then that would give you a good estimate of the, I mean, how many points will be left out of any unit ball in the whole space?
Yes, sir.
Good. But, okay, very good. And you are kind of convinced with me that whatever I told you, right? With the Chernoff, with the concentration bounds and all. But if you do the calculations here, do you think there will be a requirement on the size of this set? Okay. So if you could, I would ask you to go and maybe do these calculations yourself. So let me write it down here. So if L is at least, I think something like poly in log n. Okay, maybe not write down exactly. Is at least maybe poly, say bigger than say maybe something like n to the power some constant. Then, with high probability, you will be able to approximate or not approximate, estimate the actual delta. Okay, this delta. But what if L is a constant? So what I mean is that, again, say we have this whole thing and now I am making your life more harder. I'm saying that I don't want to even, this N is so huge that I don't even want to think of having a runtime anywhere dependent on N. Can I have a runtime of the algorithm that is independent of N? a sample complexity or something that's completely independent of n. Now this is actually doable. To explain this problem, I will go into a slightly more I'll restrict myself a bit more so that it will help me to explain it. So consider this case, okay? So I have been given n points. Say I will write it as p1 to pn, and you are given two promises, or you have been given, so an either first one, all the n points can be covered using one unit ball, or no unit ball can cover more than 1 minus delta fraction of the points. So what I have done is that I have just told that, I mean, either it is completely coverable with one unit ball, or at least delta fraction of the points are left out. Okay, so this is a special case. This is what we sometimes call as in property testing, intolerant property testing, where basically I want to distinguish between the case when the instance has the property from the case when in the instance is far from having the property. So not close and far, but has the property and far from having the property. Is this problem clear? I mean, this is like exactly what we do. And I want, maybe this is right in a different one, or maybe, can we have a constant time complexity algorithm? Now see, I have made my life even more harder, and I'm just saying that can we have a constant time complexity algorithm? Not a sublinear, it is sublinear of course, but it is even lower than that. See, if you have constant time complexity, then you will always have constant space sample space. Both of them will be there. But here I am given, okay, maybe just to, I mean, in case some of you are a bit worried about it, let's say constant sample complexity. Yeah. Is it fine? Yeah. So, can you suggest something? See, here is a simple one. Okay, I will give you the algorithm. The algorithm is that, okay, so what is a no instance? So see, I am here. I want to distinguish between these two. So if I just find, so the point to note here is that if I find three points, say P, Q and R, such that the circumradius of these three points, so P, Q and R, right? I mean, so by circumradius, I mean P, Q and R. The radius of the ball that just touches all of them is strictly more than one, then what do I know? Then I know that, of course, PQ are there, so a unit ball cannot cover these three things. So I am not in this yes instance. So I call this one as yes instance, the no instance. So then it is not an yes instance. Correct. Any problem with this? Hello.
No, sir. Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Now, what happens if the opposite happens? I say, I keep on finding 3 points. Okay. And say, is it possible? So, is it possible that the instance is a no instance? No instance. What does it mean? That it is not, cannot be covered using a unit pole. I mean, of course, cannot be covered. I mean, it's far from being covered using a no unit pole. But any 3 point can be covered using a unit unit circle. Is this possible? See, I'm looking for witnesses for rejecting in some sense. I said, okay, if I find three points that cannot be covered using a unit ball, I will reject. The perfect sense, no problem. But is it possible that what am I looking at? It might be that the whole set of points can be far from being covered by any unit ball, and still, okay, and still, any three individual points can be covered using a unit ball.
Yes, sir. For example, if all were collinear.
Okay. I didn't mean the unit circle. I don't mean the actually circumradius. Maybe that's what maybe confused you. So, yeah, I don't mean circumradius. It's like, maybe let's call this one not circumradius. I mean the coverage radius. The coverage radius. So the radius of the ball that covers all three of them.
So even in that case, for example, if I had like, let's say 6 points in a line.
Okay.
And all of them were just a little under half a unit apart.
All right.
So I could cover any three with a unit circle, but.
No. This one.
Oh, right. Sorry.
Yeah, this is not possible. I think so.
You think so?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. If any 3 point can be covered by a unit circle, yeah. I mean, that is not possible. Yeah.
I mean, can you see it, or you can guess it or believe it or something like that?
Something like I can see it, but yeah.
Yeah. I mean, your intuition is correct, but actually it is a hard thing to prove.
Okay. Maybe higher dimensions, right?
No, for three dimensional or two dimensional. Yeah, for one dimensional it is easier in some sense. Yeah. So is it possible to cover in no sense? The answer is of course no. Meaning if any 3 points can be covered using a unit ball, then all of them will be covered using a unit ball. Okay, and this I am not going to prove it, and I let it you go and check it out. It's called the Helly's theorem. It's a beautiful theorem which has the proof is actually a beautiful application of induction. That's all. It's a beautiful theorem that comes out from the combinatorial geometry. but it is not straightforward at all. And it is true for any dimension. Okay. Now, so what does it mean? So what does Halley's theorem say? Halley's theorem, I will write the contrapositive of that Halley's theorem, okay? That if the end, the instance is not a yes instance, meaning, okay, if the instance is not a yes instance, or maybe I will, if the instance is not a yes instance, that means it cannot be covered using a unit ball, then there exist three points P, Q, and R such that P, Q, and R cannot be covered using a unit ball. Okay? Good. So if I do this following problem, so say here is my algorithm, therefore. What is my algorithm? My algorithm is pick three points at random, three points P, Q, and R. If the circum radius, or if the what is the coverage radius of P, Q, and R is less than one, then accept. Else reject, or then output yes. Else output no. Now is this algorithm fine? All I'm doing is that I'm trying to find out three points which are far. And by Halley's theorem, something that I have not proved, I know that there exist three points. But what do you think this algorithm will, what will happen to this? Will this be, how good an algorithm will it be? See, of course, it's a randomization. So what my question is that what is the probability that the algorithm outputs correctly? What is this? Can you say that? Any idea?
So I don't think it will output incorrectly. I mean, this will be a totally correct algorithm. Or should be, because...
Okay, yeah. Why? Okay, so there are two places. Okay, what happens in the case of yes instance? In the yes instance, of course, our algorithm will pick up three points. Those three points are, of course, covered with a unit ball.
Yes,
probability of correctness is actually one.
It's one, yes. But in no instance, it can, yes.
But in the no instance, right? It is not zero. The probability of correctness is not zero.
Exactly. Yes, yes.
It is not zero. That much I can say. But is it good? Okay. So the issue that can happen is that, there exists only three points. Right? But those three can be hidden somewhere. And all I'm doing is that I'm picking up three points at random. So the only way this algorithm can be successfully catch no instances, if in the Halley's theorem, we kind of have to rectify it to some level, that if the instance is a, instead of saying that it's a no instance, is a yes instance, okay, if it is a yes, if the instance is a no instance, meaning if it is far from coverable using one unit ball, then there exists a lot of triples, lot of triples points such that this happens. So that means a randomly picked PQ and R with some non-trivial probability would give me a witness that the balls cannot be covered using, the points cannot be covered using elite balls. Okay, so now this is actually a true statement, and this is what comes out from what is called a fractional hill. Okay, again, something that I am not going to prove, but this is a true, again, a true thing. And so in that case, what you will, if you do this whole thing, so basically this algorithm, the Helly's theorem, a fractional Helly's theorem says that, see, if you are a no instance, meaning if you are far from being coverable using unit ball, then not only there exists 3 points that cannot be covered using a unit ball, but a lot of 3 points are there that cannot be covered using a unit ball. Okay? So if I pick 3 points at random, then with that reasonable probability, I will be able to catch it. Okay, so in fact, in that case, this will become something which is a number. I mean, I think it will be something like, yeah, something like delta or something like that. Okay. But here is the algorithm. So the algorithm, therefore, with probability at least, no, sorry, it will be kind of, we can make it into 1 minus delta. So with probability 1 minus delta, the algorithm will be able to correctly solve this problem. And what is the time complexity or sample complexity? Wow, it is just a sample complexity is? Just 3, or in other words, I can say it to be constant, right? So with this new, so all the, what did we do? With the extra bit of knowledge that I am more worried about the yes instance and no instance and not somewhere in the middle, I will be able to, or one can try to come up with sublinear algorithms or even constant time complexity, sample complexity, space complexity algorithms that will be able to help us to distinguish between the yes instance and no instance. This is what is property testing. Okay. Now, any questions so far? I know I am supposed to maybe stop at 12 o'clock, but I will just take 5 more minutes before I kind of give you a break at this time. Okay. So let me go back to this kind of a quick introduction that was there to recap where we are. So you have seen a lot of kind of algorithms so far. You have seen deterministic algorithms, which solves the problem exactly. You have seen randomized algorithms that solves the problem with high probability and saves on running time. You have seen approximation algorithms that tries to approximate output and approximate solution to the problem. So this also helps to solve running time. But all of them has a, or there's also the parameterized algorithms, which is you can solve it exactly and quickly for certain small parameters. But everything that you have done so far is crucially dependent on the fact that I have looked at all the whole input. So all of them has a running time, which is polynomial in N. In fact, I mean, polynomial in N is not the right word. Maybe it's a bigger than N. So what happens if you don't even read, or if you are not even allowed to read the whole input? You don't even have the time or space to read the whole input. In such a case, what can you do? And This is a very important question in the modern day data big data stuff, because first of all, you want to answer something in very small time, ideally a time that is completely independent of the size of the input, because in the next 1 hour we will see possibly some another example where you have the input size is huge, so huge that it's like even log is not a good idea or something. I mean, so you hope to just do it with a constant number of size thing, right? And or it can be also be that the accessing is very hard. Like a typical example is that right now this COVID was going on very hard, right? And we want to understand some information about the COVID infection. How quickly this is spreading? I don't know whether you guys followed it or not, but there is this R factor and all these factors were there. How do you estimate that R factor? How do you estimate whether how many people have got which strain of it? So accessing the data is hard, costly. So in such situations, you don't expect to go and test out every possible human being in the whole planet. Instead, you try to understand it by kind of doing some sampling or trying to reduce the number of accessing time that has to be done, right? So property testing is exactly that. And we want to solve something in sublinear query complexity. We usually call it query complexity, but usually if the query complexity or number of parts of the input itself becomes constant size, then the algorithm itself becomes constant, right? Algorithm's time complexity becomes constant. Or if it is a very small fraction, then the algorithm's time complexity also will become very small, like number. Right? So this is what property testing is. And of course, you have to give something. So what is the something that we give up because of this not reading this stuff? That we are only going to answer if there's a yes instance or no instance. And if there's a gap between the yes instance and no instance, where we are allowed to make any error. So here is an algorithm problem that is possibly the most simple problem that is there. That is checking equality. That giving two strings, X and Y, I want to check whether X is equals to Y or not. Right? Now I can tell you, this is a problem that you guys have all solved it yourself in many times in your life. For example, you have bought a book. Your friend has bought the same book, but a different edition of it. And you are interested to check, are these two books similar or different? Maybe the table of contents are similar, maybe the various things are similar, but you are more interested in maybe the table and content are similar, the pages are more or less similar numbers and all, same size books and so on. But is it possible that there are some changes in the middle, some text that has been changed? How much fraction of it has been changed? So what do? You randomly open a page number and check for it. Oh, can you see the number, page number 105? Okay, is it this line written there? Yeah, okay, fine. If this is written there, fine. We repeat it a few times with different set of pages or areas. And then we kind of say, okay, I mean, even if there is some differences, they are very minor. We don't worry about it that much. Right? So there we are already doing some kind of property testing. Because the idea is that if the inputs are far from each other, meaning if the two books are significantly different in their content, then you should be able to quickly reject. And else, if it is close to each other, then we are like, okay, fine, we are kind of accepting. So we have also had this clustering problem that we kind of just now discussed a little bit in more details. You can have problems like this, like you have this huge graph. So think that the internet graph, and we want to check is the internet graph k colorable. And whether the internet graph is k colorable or not, we are more worried about is it close to k colorable or far from k colorable. And I don't even want to go and look at all the possible vertices in that internet graph. How do you solve it? This is another thing that given I have a function, I want to change the function property. Is the function linear or not? Again, something. Now, this particular thing, the reason I always keep this one in my slide is that this is possibly the start of the whole area of property testing. And if you guys are interested in it, I can just point you out to this thing that there is this area called PCP, probabilistically checkable proofs, and this particular setting is the almost one of the crucial parts of the PCP theorem. Now, have you guys seen PCP in this thing at all, or heard of this thing? No, I assume.
No, okay. I don't.
Okay, fine. So, but in case you are interested, then you can look at it offline. And then there is the other thing is that about distributions. And this is something that I'm going to talk about a bit more properly in the next 1 hour. So just to kind of wrap up and formalize. Okay, let me stop now. I will come back and try to formalize this the property testing in the theoretical aspect, and then go into this last one, the uniformity of distribution and how that connects to another very important area of research that's going on right now. So before I kind of go ahead, I just realized that I have not told you one thing. Like here in the problem that we kind of discussed earlier, whether we can test whether something can be say this kind of stuff, right? Whether it can be covered using one ball or not. And I kind of told that because of this fractional Helly's property, we can't solve it. I didn't give a formal proof of it, but you can take my word and you can go back and basically check out these statements of fractional Helly and so on, and we'll get it. But there is an open problem here, which is a very interesting open problem. Okay, so in short, what I can say is that for k equals to 1, we have a constant sample algorithm for checking if the points are one clusterable, say, or covertible within one unit ball or k cluster. This is only for the case when k equals to 1. That's what I explained. I also explained only for the case when it is either completely clusterable or far from being clusterable, but that's fine. And this one is true for any d, for any dimension of the ambient space. But what about for k equals bigger than or equal to 2? Meaning if I have n points and I'm asking, can you cluster them using 2 balls, or can you cluster them with 3 balls? And the question is that, okay, so we want to know whether it can be clustered using 2 balls or it can be far from clusterable using 3 balls. Okay. And we want to do it by kind of constant sample complexity. This is open. and it is actually open, but I mean there is something more that is known about it, and it is not something that is not too hard. I mean, it can be possibly done. It has a beautiful connections to combinatorial geometry. Geometry and some very nice algorithms that are there. So in case you guys are interested, I mean, this is the problem that you can start thinking about. A problem that is very much in the breadth of the big data kind of stuff, where you are really testing for clustering, but in sublinear queries. Okay. Also, the other thing that I should kind of mention is that I talked about circles, right? So circles is basically, what are circles? Circles are distances in what we call as the Euclidean distance or L2 distance. Meaning, if you take a point and consider all the points, so take a center and look at all the points that are at distance or L2 distance, or the Euclidean distance, say D from or R from that point, this is what we get is a circle. But what happens if I talk about different distances? So what about L1 distance? What about L infinity distance? Now, if you are not familiar with these properties, that's perfectly fine. Yes, here that these are other metrics that exist on the space that you can talk about. And based on that, which one of these we are looking at, you can have different shapes. So like, for example, the L1 will not give you a ball, instead it will give you a square centered at that point. And so on and so forth. So you can have different such kind of things that can come up. So even for them, for certain things are known, some things are not known, and so on. So this is a very rich area of work that is going on. So the main idea is that even before you kind of go into applying some complicated algorithms to find out the best clustering, check quickly, is it clusterable or is it far from clusterable? And this is basically where proper testing comes in. Okay, so before I go proceed further, do you have any questions about whatever has been done so far? I'm flexible in how I want to go in the next 1 hour or so. So if you have some particular points that you want me to talk about, or particular directions you want to, particular problems you want me to discuss, I'll be happy to do that. Nothing?
Saurav, can I give my premise?
Sure.
Some graph algorithms.
Okay. So, okay, fine. Okay, I will then talk about some graph algorithms. Yeah. So, good. So, before I go into the graph algorithms part, let me just maybe use my 3 minutes to kind of formalize this concept of property testing. I mean, this is just so that you guys realize that there is a formal setting of this whole stuff. So what is the property? What is the property basically? I'll forget all of these things. Oh, there is some graph algorithms over here. There, I come back. Yeah. So we will think of an input as a 0, 1 to the n. I mean, it doesn't matter. I mean, what does that input indicate? That input can indicate just a vector, or it can indicate a adjacency matrix of a graph, or it can indicate a set of points. Doesn't matter, right? So always you think of an input as an n-dimensional 0-1 vector. And what's the property? So property is nothing but a subset of this whole space, right? And the question that we ask, and the distance between any two inputs, is it the So I have two points, x and y, in the space, and we are interested in the fraction of the bits where this x and y differ. Right. And when I say that an input is far from having a property, or is at a distance something from a property, what do I mean? We mean that the closest string that satisfies the property, what is the distance of x from that? So minimum over all the strings in the property, what is the distance of x from y? Okay. So usually we say that if x is epsilon far from having a property, that means that the distance of x from the property is more than epsilon, meaning you can think of it in two different ways. One option is that the string which is so among all the strings that satisfies the property, the distances of x from those strings is at least epsilon. But the other way is thinking of it is that I have to change x at least epsilon fraction of the points to make it satisfy the property. Right. And basically we are interested in this promise problem usually, that given an input x and a property p, we were interested in checking is x in the property or is x far from having the property. Okay, so this is the problem that we work on. It doesn't matter what is the problem. This is the framework always. Right. Note that there exists a gap here between A and B, right? Between the, say, we will call this one the yes instance and this is the no instance. Between the yes instance and no instance, there is a gap. And the algorithm is basically not, so we want to design an algorithm, okay? So under this assumption, meaning if the input is either the yes instance or the no instance, we want to have a sublinear algorithm. If the input doesn't satisfy any of these, either of this A or B, I don't care. If the input algorithm can do whatever it wants, it is not going to be penalized for whatever it outputs. Okay. And, so this is basically the high level picture, and in this property testing has a huge bit of connections with lots of areas of machine learning, checking of programs. So this is something that I'm not going to talk about now that Venkatesh has requested for this graph properties, but program checking is basically, if you are familiar with it, that nowadays one of the big things that is coming up is called probabilistic language. So basically, it's a probabilistic program. So not a programming language, probabilistic program. But our goal of a program is not to solve and is not to output an yes and no, but it's supposed to output something according to a distribution. So all the neural networks, all the AI-based stuff and all is basically this. So I give you a handwriting. It is not supposed to output me. The goal of the algorithm is not to completely say that, oh, you have written A or you have written B or something. The goal of the algorithm actually is to output that by looking at this input, your handwritten value of A, I think with 90% probability, this should be A. Maybe with 5% probability, it can be 0. With 3% probability, it can be D and so on. And this is kind of natural, right? Because when somebody writes A, even if you look at it, right? So if somebody comes up and says, oh, see, this is A, is this A or this is B? Not very clear, right? So how do you expect an algorithm to output the exact value? It's not. So it's algorithm is supposed to output either A or D or maybe some other number, 0 or God knows what, according to a probability distribution. So A should come up with probability 0.9, maybe D should come up with probability 0.08 and so on and so forth. Right? So the goal is that an algorithm is supposed to output according to a distribution. That is the inherent structure of neural networks. It's the inherent structure of most of the AI-based stuff. Unfortunately, most of the algorithms don't have any formal proof of correctness. So the only way that we can try to check whether something is correct or wrong is by sampling and testing it empirically. And then it comes down. So that means an algorithm is outputting according to some distribution. How do I check whether that distribution has some nice property or not? Right? So then there are connections of this property testing to other areas of research also, which are not necessarily application based, but more from the point of view of theoretical interest, like communication complexity, coding theory, and cryptography, and so on. And I think I will just not worry about it, whatever happens here. But maybe I can just go. So if you don't have any other doubts or questions of whatever has been done so far, I will then jump into this another example of graph algorithm. Any questions, any doubts, any comments? Nothing? Okay, so let me just go directly to the, so we have still now seen algorithms for the geometric problems. The next thing that one can ask is simple things about graph problems. Like we kind of discussed it, right? So I will say that, okay, I have been given a graph G and check, I want to check what? Check if G is K colorable. I mean, I'm going to choose this particular K colorable problem, but you can choose any of them, any other properties that you want, and we can go about it and try to understand. Now, with the case of graph algorithms, there is a slight issue. Issue is that is true for almost any graph problems, okay? But usually if you are just interested in polynomial time algorithms, it doesn't matter. But here, a big issue is how is the graph given? See, we are not going to look at all the whole graph, right? That's a typical answer of typical property of property testing. So how the graph is given is a big thing. So there are various ways one can think about it. Okay. So there is one way, of course, in which you can say, oh, okay, it can be given as an adjacency matrix. So in this case, the idea is that I can pick up a kind of a, what we call as a query. What is a query? It's like we kind of ask that, is there an edge between, say, Vi and Vj? This is a question that one can ask. So this is like one bit of information that I can ask from the graph. This is how I access the graph. Okay, so in that case, of course, if I am making, so if the graph is, of course, I'm assuming that the graph has n vertices. So if the graph has n vertices, then by making n square edges, n square queries, or order n square queries, I will be able to get to know of the whole graph, right? But the question is now, therefore, I want to answer this question by making much less number of queries, sublinear number of queries, even constant number of queries. Can I do that? Okay. And then there are other things, of course, as you can might have expected, there is this adjacency least. And in that case, what's the query? Now, adjacently, you cannot ask this question. This question is a hard question to answer. Be completely with zero information coming out there. So in this case, the question is am I audible? My connection seems that it is unstable a bit. Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, my connection just told that the internet is
some unstable. Very small gaps in between, but now it's okay.
Okay, fine. Yeah, so adjacency list says that what is the ith neighbor of Vj? So this is a question that I can ask. Now, see, this is, what it means, the ith neighbor? Of course, we think that the adjacency matrix, adjacency list is kind of ordered in some way. I don't care what way. Okay. Now, this is good because then possibly you can start getting some nice ideas. So there are these two models and there are some other models. Okay, there are quite a number of models that kind of ask. And I don't want to go into this whole list of models. So it is a bit of a model specific. Okay, so graph properties is a bit of model specific property. So let me just focus on this problem, this one. So this is my favorite property model to work with. And this is what is called the dense graph model. Okay, so this is what is called as the dense graph model. And so in this model, say I want to answer this question. So of course, I don't want to answer this question, right? We want, because we are not going to read the whole algorithm. Say for example, the graph might be of this form, right? So it's a huge bipartite graph. A massively huge bipartite graph, let's say the huge bipartite graph is there. But there is one edge here. So this is a graph that is basically bipartite. There's one edge that just hangs around there. So if I have to answer whether this graph is bipartite or two colorable or not, I have to, of course, go and try to find out all the possible edges. Else chances that I will be able to catch this edge is very low. So in the world of property testing, what is it that we want? We have been therefore given a graph G, and I'm assuming in the adjacency matrix form. And what is it that we want? We want to distinguish between these two following things. Is G bipartite? I've of course gone down from K coloring to two coloring, but you can do everything in that K coloring world also. So that means if it is bipartite, then I want to answer yes. But if it is not, then I should have some amount of gap, right? I have some amount of leeway. So the question is that if G is far from bipartite, then I should output no. Now, can you guys say what does this far from bipartite means? How would you like to kind of quantify it? How would you like to quantify this far from bipartite thing? Any suggestions?
The number of edges to be removed to make the graph G bipartite.
Right. So that is one very good way of writing. See, there again, lot of ways you can define it. Okay. So one can say the far from bipartite means that there are a lot of cycles. So that can be one way. If it is a lot of odd cycles. So if a graph is far from bipartite, if G has a lots and lots of odd cycles. But say we use a slightly different one, as you kind of pointed out, we say that that means G. So brother, so one has to remove at least say epsilon fraction of the edges. To make the graph bipartite. Now, just to kind of not to worry about it, I will not even write this one as epsilon fraction of the edges. Instead, I will say that at least epsilon n square number of edges. Okay. To make it bipartite. So let's start with this. So I have a graph on n vertices and I want to distinguish between these two facts. Is G bipartite and is G far from bipartite? That means, do I have to remove an epsilon n square number of edges to make it bipartite? So note that that means that if there is one particular one particular vertex or one particular edge, or from one vertex there are edges to all the other vertices, that's just n of them, right? So these are all what we can consider as perfectly fine bipartite. They are not far from bipartite. Right? So do you guys have suggestions about how we can go about doing this? Just recollect this kind of this geometric problem. There also we were trying to catch a witness. Right? We were trying to catch a witness by saying that, oh, see this graph, there we told that, okay, there are 3 points. If I find 3 points that cannot be covered using a unit ball, then the set of points cannot be covered using a unit ball. So here also, if you do that same thing, can we come up with a witness where we hope that I should be able to catch a witness with that? What's the witness of non-bipartiteness there?
A subgraph or a cycle of odd length.
A cycle of a odd length, right? A subgraph that contains a cycle of an odd length, right? So the hope is to catch a cycle of odd length. Now, it might very well be that there exists an odd length cycle. But that odd length cycle minimum length of odd length cycle is huge. If that is the case, then do you have much hope of that? So what if all the odd length cycles are of length, say pretty huge. Say bigger, much bigger than say bigger than square root n. Say. In that case, to capture, to catch hold of a cycle of odd length, I will have to make square root n number of samples, right? Or queries. So, I mean, what would a optimist kind of hope for? So, optimist will kind of try to write an algorithm of this form, right? Let's say he's an optimist. That pick a subgraph of size something, say some kind of some size. Okay, I'm not writing it here, say size S. I don't know what that S is. And if we see an odd cycle, what does it mean? If you see an odd cycle, that means the graph has already been proved that it is not a bipartite graph. So I can safely say that, oh, it is not a bipartite graph, so it's not an ES instance. So I can say that, oh, in that case, it is a, then I am the output no. And else, okay, I have not got a proof that it is not bipartite, but I have not able to catch any odd cycle. So in some sense, I kind of say that, okay, since I'm optimist, so I hope that I should have been able to catch this odd cycle, but then I say that, okay, in that case, I will output yes. So this is an optimist algorithm. Of course, there is an unspecified set S over here, unspecified number S over here, but otherwise an optimist would think like this. In this case, can you do something? What is the probability? So what is the probability of the algorithm outputting correctly? What do you, can you help me to calculate it? Yeah. Any suggestions? How do you hope to calculate it?
If the graph is bipartite, then it will always be correct.
Yeah. So, right. So, if it is the ES instance, right? That means if it is bipartite, then the probability of correctness is always 1. It's exactly like this. Excellent. So, if the probability is a no instance, then what is the probability? Now, last time you had this thing that in the case of this clustering problem, we kind of told that this is always non-zero because of Halley's theorem, but we were not sure how can we make it to be a constant or something. But here we don't even know it to be a constant, know it to be non-zero. So is it possible that it is of course possible that if a graph is not bipartite, the closest or the smallest cycle can be huge. It is possible, right? So in other words, we know that, so this is something we know, that if it is not an ES instance, not an ES instance, meaning if it is not bipartite, then there can be, then the smallest length of odd cycle can be large. That we know. This is a fact. We know that. But note that we have not yet used the promise that we have. We are in the regime in which either the graph is bipartite or the graph is far from bipartite. So it is not, this is not that whether it is an yes instance. What we want is a different. What is want is if a no instance, in that case what happens? See, the correctness probability is only for the no instance that we have to worry, not for the not an yes instance. So if there's no instance, then what is the probability? Then is it possible that the smallest cycle, odd cycle, is also very large? So this is you can write it as a lemma or a theorem or something. Again, I'm not going to give a proof of it, but I'll state it that if no instance, so no instance, if you go back here, note that there is a, where is it gone? Yeah, so there was this epsilon, right? I kind of discussed here, when we talked about. So that means that you have to remove epsilon fraction of the edges, or epsilon n square edges, to make it, to make all the odd cycles disappear. So then what we can say is that there exists a cycle, there exists an odd cycle of length less than or equal to 1 by epsilon squared. This is a pure graph theoretic property that if I have a graph that is far from bipartite, meaning you have to remove a lot of edges to make it bipartite, then the size of the odd cycle, smallest odd cycle, will also be very small. Okay, and this is something very useful fact. So if this is the case, so that means if I take this S to be equals to 1 by epsilon square or something like that, then in this no instance, we have this probability that at least non-zero. So there is some chance that I will hope to catch it. Okay, I'm not proving you this lemma. I will let you guys go and think about it. It is not easy, but it's not hard also. So what you can prove even is something more. What you can prove is that not only there exists an odd cycle, you can also prove that there exists a lot of odd cycles of length less than or equal to 1 by epsilon squared. So recall, just like the case in the case of this geometric thing, where we prove that not only there exists one triple, which kind of is a witness for the fact that it cannot be clustered in the one ball, there should be a lot of triples, here also you can prove that not only there exists a odd cycle of small length, there exist a lot of odd cycles of small length, and which means that once you do an expectation, once you take a random, so now if I pick up a random subgraph of some particular size, then what you can show is that the no instance will not only be non-zero, in the case of no sense, the probability of correctness, this will be pretty high. So something like 2/3 or something, you can make it. It can make it a constant. So just like there, it was the combinatorial geometry that was pushing this result. Here, there is this object of the graph theory that is pushing this result. Okay. Now, okay, any questions on this particular set problem? Is this clear, this whole thing of testing of bipartiteness? So if you, once you have the testing of bipartiteness, you can have a similar result for something like, what if G is K colorable? Okay, this is the property that you can solve. What is if G has a independent size of some independent size of size independent set of size of size greater than or equal to K. So by the way, this, all of these things can be made into let me just write down, say, or if G is G has a clique or something like that of size bigger than or equal to K. There is a lot of this kind of set of questions that can be asked, and all of them can be answered using the property testing can be done using constant number of samples or queries, whatever you want. So here it's not called samples, it's called queries. By basically looking at only a constant bit of the adjacency matrix, can you make this kind of can you solve all of them? Now, in fact, there is a very nice theorem over here, and that's a very powerful theorem. It's called the hereditary properties. So what are hereditary properties? So say, consider the property of bipartiteness, right? So G is bipartite, right? Now, if I remove an H from the G, will it remain bipartite or not remain bipartite? What do you think? If I have G which has bipartite, if I remove an H, will it remain bipartite or will it not remain bipartite?
It will.
It will, right? Similarly, if a G has an independent set of size K, If I remove an edge, will it have an independent set of size k or not? It will. So, in other words, if I have a property P, okay, a property P is called, so what is a property P by the way? A property P in this case is a P is a set of a, this is a subset of, So this is property P, this is a set of graphs, right? And if G in P implies G minus some edge E also in P, then P is called hereditary. Now there is a lot of this kind of stuff there, and these hereditary properties are very special, and what was proved or can be proved is that if, so this is a big theorem, if P is an hereditary property, then there exists a tester, so it's a property tester of P using constant number of queries. This is a very big theorem. This is by Noga Allen, Shapira, Fisher. I'm not doing it in a very right order. And there's one more person, I think. And there's another paper, independent paper of this one, which also, but they also do it in a completely different way. But this is a very big result. I am nowhere close to trying to solve this problem, but I'm trying to tell you this problem, this theorem, because this is one of the more celebrated theorems in this world of property testing. It basically, in one go, any hereditary property was proved to be testable or testable using constant number of queries. And just like in the case of, say, here in the bipartite case, there was this such a lemma that was kind of talked about, right? And so on. How do you solve all of them in one go? All the properties in one go? And the crucial part here is what is called the regularity lemma. Are you guys familiar with regularity lemma? Have you heard or seen that in this set of lectures?
No, sir.
No. Okay. Again, I'm not going to it. But if you guys are interested in graph theory or graph algorithms, this is a lemma to look at. I mean, this will completely blow your mind and just mesmerize you like anything. It basically kind of says that any graph can be thought of, or any graph is basically can be divided into some set of random graphs. And what is a random graph? A random graph is a graph which has some nice properties, okay. Basically, where every edge, if you pick up a graph where every edge is picked up with probability P, and I construct a graph like that, then that graph has some nice properties that you can do there's some expected number of edges between any two subsets and all that can be all worked out. So regularity lemma says that this can be, or any graph can be broken up into a constant number of random graphs. And since it can be done in that way, using this lemma, or using this, always called a lemma, it's actually a massive big theorem. So you can prove this particular property, this particular thing. So this kind of, you can kind of understand that there are this, all these graph properties have been answered in this world. But before I go ahead with something else, let me tell you, I have used this word constant a few times. What is constant here? Nobody stopped me actually, nobody asked me. So for example, in this algorithm, is this a constant? Is it a constant query complexity algorithm? Hello?
So constant could be something that doesn't depend on the input.
So here it does depend on the input. It depends on epsilon. So usually when we say in the world of property testing, constant is something that doesn't depend of the size of the structure that we are testing. It is just a function of the parameters. Epsilon is a parameter. It kind of decides, it's a parameter that says that how much amount of a leeway that you will give. What is that the promise gives you? Or the gap between the yes instance and no instance. How much is that? Okay. Now here you see, here we are actually picking up some 1/ε² number of say size, right? I mean, if I take a subgraph of size this much, then I have to query 1/ε⁴ number of edges. Okay. But it is depends on epsilon, but not on the size of the graph. Right? So this algorithm, what it says is that, okay, this is an constant, this is a constant which is a function of epsilon, but it not depends upon the inputs, the size of the instance, okay, the size of the object, size of the graph. So good. So here we are. We have managed to answer this question. So any hereditary property we can solve using constant number of queries, where constant is a function of epsilon. But how low is epsilon should be? Usually the epsilon is something like say 0.01, say 1% of error I am allowed to handle, right? So this basically means that I want to accept a graph that is bipartite and reject a graph where I have to remove say 0.01 or 1% of the all the edges to make it bipartite. 1% is a big number, right? In the world of big data and all those things. So to make this whole thing of any importance in the world of application, I have to kind of have an eye on how big is this epsilon. So I started with a very motivating stuff saying that, oh, see, I need to reduce the amount of space and all those kind of stuff. And I have a function which depends on epsilon, okay, and doesn't depend on n. That's a good start. But this, how bad is this function? Do you know how bad is this function? This function is 2 to the power, you keep on going. How much you go, how many things you have, this is a polynomial in 1/ε. So here we are. This number is, if you can visualize it, this number is horrendous, and therefore, although this beautiful theorem proves theoretically that any hereditary property can be tested using constant number of queries, the constant is actually useless. Because you don't expect anybody to write a program that uses this much amount of samples. This is, I mean, kind of like, this is more than the number of atoms in the universe, kind of stuff like that. Okay. So this is where we are. Okay. So for example, I'll give you an example. Okay. So the question here, G. So given graph G, is G triangle free? Does it have no triangles or not? Or is it far from being triangle free? We have a, so you can kind of quickly verify that this is actually a hereditary property. So if it is triangle free and if I remove an edge, it still remains triangle free. So using this, we do have a very, we do have a constant. So we have a constant query testing algorithm. Okay, very good. This is a good point. But the problem is that this constant is this constant. So this is useless. So this is impractical. So the open problem here is that can you design a testing algorithm with the query complexity? How much query complexity? Maybe I'm allowed to make some query complexity, which is fine. I am not worried. I mean, I don't want to allow more than epsilon to the power, say, 10. That's already, I think, is too much. And maybe I am not too worried about making this one constant. I may be happy to have log n over here. So this is not in the definition, theoretical definition, this is not constant. But such an algorithm, if done, will be a much more practical problem. Can you test, can you design a testing algorithm for triangle freeness with query complexity? This is open. There are lots of this kind of stuff that are open. In the modern day, with the data, with the set of work on big data coming up, there is a push. I mean, property testing seems to be the most natural subject that can take a central position for big data. Because you are trying to answer things by not even looking at the whole set of inputs, right? By looking at a very small fraction of the input. And so the hope is that, great, so here is it. I have all these beautiful algorithms. Why don't I go and apply to various things? I want to test whether the Facebook graph, what is the connectivity of the Facebook graph? Or LinkedIn wants to check out with how many, say, the heavy vertices are there. I mean, heavy degree vertices are there. Or some kind of a, is there a kind of a clustering on the set of tweeters? These are kind of very important questions that are asked left and right. So this is how you kind of try to understand how information passes, how some fake news is going from one place to the another, or if somebody wants to spread some news, how many places an advertisement has to be done. There's a lot and lots of ways you can ask these questions, right? I mean, the graph property. And your job is therefore, given a huge data like this, say the Facebook graph, you want to check or ask, is it, does it have a, or can it be covered using K-clicks? Or not, right? So such kind of questions are natural that we apply property testing results. And theoretically, we have got all of it covered. We have constant query complexities for all of them. Except that the constant that we have makes them impractical. So here is a very interesting place, something that has been fascinating me for some time, that a slight difference between what the theoreticians like and want to prove and can prove, and what the people who are in the industry wants and has it in their disposal. So this is a big area. And people have been now trying to look at these areas and this designing new algorithms where, so like for example, this such an algorithm would be an inferior algorithm in the eye of a theoretician, because the constant is, this query complexity is not constant. Asymptotically, this number is worse than any function of epsilon. But from a practical person's point of view, this number is 1,000 times, I mean, like is infinitely better than a number like this. So you can see more of this kind of stuff that has come up. I can maybe give you some links to some nice papers and all which where it has come out. And in the as an application of property testing, or the, say the current version, the current status of property testing in the view of applications. Okay, this is something that has been going on quite some time. Okay, so there is a gap between theoretical and practical things. So what all theoreticians have done till now? So the theoreticians have first of all designed the models. Say, this is how the bits can be accessed, or this is the cost of accessing. And accordingly have designed algorithms that are asymptotically good. Kali, nice. Now this is what the theoreticians have done, and this is a beautiful area of research, no doubt about that. But from the practical person's point of view, from the practitioner's point of view, they sometimes can, they are now saying that, see, the model that you are working is a bit too restricted. Sometimes some more powerful models of accessing can be allowed. Say, for example, in the case of graphs, now what the practitioners are saying is that, see, if you want to know the degree of a vertex, I can answer that question in very quickly. So for that, you don't need to have order n amount of query. In the model, theoretician's model, to know the degree of a vertex, I need to make n queries. From a practitioner's model, they are saying that no, degree of a vertex can be easily given. Our data structures are so well organized that can be answered in order one time. So now the practitioners are making the models more powerful. You are allowed to make lots of different things. But the idea is to now design algorithms that are practical. And there are a lot of work that has been going on. So now in the world of property testing, there are a lot of places when there's a back and forth between the theoreticians and practitioners going on. The models are changing, problems are changing, and accordingly you have to design this stuff. So maybe I should stop here as a kind of talking about the property testing and its connections to the big data and applications and all. So in short, there are these beautiful theoretical results that exist in various areas. Like I've just talked about geometry and graph theory. You can have the similar stuff in distributions, which is a very big area. Areas in functional properties. And lots of these areas exist there. And I've only focused on a very, 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 very tiny fraction of the, I mean, I've just really focused on two problems. So there's not much that I can talk about there. But I should also point out here that property testing as it is, as it was maybe 10 years ago, was not that applicable to practical world because of some inherent problems in the definition of the asymptotic stuff or much more restricted versions of the model. So right now, there are lots of places where this whole area has been revived all over again when the practitioners are giving the model, saying that, oh, see, this is a model, and in this model, can you do something? And you have to give me some practical algorithms. So algorithm, the constants are not arbitrarily large. It is something nice. And yeah. So maybe I will stop here now. If you have any questions, doubts, I mean, feel free to ask me.
Thanks, Saurav. I think if anybody has a question, then please unmute yourself and ask question to Saurav.
Saurav, a couple of quick questions.
Yeah.
So this definition of far.
Yeah.
You said is at least epsilon n square edges.
Right, right.
Are there variations of this definition?
Oh, there is a lot of variation of this. Okay. Of course, one of the things I kind of brushed in the side is that epsilon of the total number of edges that exist in the graph.
Okay.
That's a more natural one. And
for example, is that general theorem you mentioned for
heredity? No. The general theorem is only for what I told for the epsilon n square.
Okay.
It's called the dense graph model. Okay.
So for specific properties.
Then it is called the sparse graph model, and such a theorem we don't know in the sparse graph model.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a big area that is also open.
Now, the other question is, are there lower bounds, for example, where some properties you cannot test in constant under
yes.
some
kind? There are. For example, one proper function graph property that we can talk about is basically, so I have given you a graph G. So I have a graph G1, which I know myself, it is there in my hand, and I have a graph G2. That is, I have to sample. Okay, so this is in the hard disk, and this is with me. Okay, so this is with me. So with me meaning I don't have to query or do anything, and this is in the hard disk. Okay, this is I have to sample. And I ask, what is G1 and G2 isomorphic? And there, what you prove is that, okay, so what you can prove is that you need the squaring complexity. Complexity is omega of square root n. Now, I am not going to say much about the square root n thing, how does it come, but maybe let me just give you quickly, it's going to a slightly different place and you will understand how the square root n kind of coming up, okay? So say I have these two functions. So I have a function, okay? I have a function that is from 1 to n to 1 to n. Okay, this is function 1. And I have a function 2 that is from 1 to n to 1 to n. Okay, now what is this function? First function, f1 is 1 to 1. Okay, but f2 is either 1 to 1 or it is 2 to 1. Okay, that means the range of f is, the two of them maybe goes to one of them. And I want to identify, I want to query f2 and ask, is f2, so I want to sample f2 and ask, is f2 1, 2 to 1 or 1 to 1? Now the idea is that if I make a sample, what is it? I will ask something like, oh, what is f2 of x? I will get some answer, say 5. I will take another, what is x2 of y? I will get another thing, 4. So note that I keep on getting different answers. And as long as I'm getting different answers, I kind of think that these are all same. So the function f2 can be 1 to 1. Only when I somehow, luckily, I ask a question, what is f2 of a, and I get something that I've already seen, then I get to know that, oh, okay. Now I know that f2, two different domain elements goes to the same one. And so that means f2 must be 2 to 1. So question is that how many number of samples do we need to pick up before we identify or before we hope to catch two different domain elements that matches to the same thing in this case. And this is actually square root n. Okay, so number of samples required in this case is more than square root n. And the reason, you can go and try to work it out in your later on, but I can write it, this is what we call as the inverse of birthday paradox. If you have seen this particular thing somewhere, fine, else you can also, this is something very useful thing to know. So using this, you can kind of say that unless I make square root n number of samples, I'm no way I'm going to, very low chance that I will be able to catch something, catch two points which lands up in the same place. Okay, so basically the same concept can be used to kind of get a lower bound of something like this. By the way, I should say the same thing, Venkatesh, I'm just taking 2 more minutes here. So there are lots of, in this area of property testing, we can produce a lot of lower bounds. And this is one simple one, but there are a lot of lower bounds here. But in this problem that I kind of defined here, in this stuff that we defined here, right? In here, in this theorem, where we kind of told that the F epsilon is this quantity. So a natural question happens is that can you come up with the lower bound of the number of samples required in terms of epsilon? Not in terms of n, but in terms of epsilon. And that has also been done. not too much better, we can get a lower bound of 1 over epsilon to the power 3 or something like that. And that area is very, very non-trivial. They go through hardcore algebraic geometric techniques. So I don't want to go into it, but yes, I wanted to say that there exist lower bound results even in terms of function of epsilon.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Okay, if not, thanks Saurav for a wonderful talk.